Blog Talk Radio.
Theme song for tonight and this great show coming out of Cleveland, Ohio. It's American Sports History Podcast, hosted by a brother, a friend and a mentor to me, Peter Ray. Yours truly producing it out here in Los Angeles as the rain comes down. Hey, it could be worse. I could be back east battling the snow and everything back there, but blessed enough to be out here. 347-205-9631. We'll get you live. Anything after that, catch the archive version, blogtalkradio.com/Mancini Sports, podcast platforms, whatever podcast you get across the realm of these things. This is now part of Mancini Media. So without further ado, let me lay the red carpet down, put the podium in its place, and hand it off the mic to you, Peter, and the threes. How are you? How can people get a hold of you? And a great guest you're bringing in again tonight.
Hi, Mark. I'm doing well. I have a YouTube channel. It's my name, Peter, J.REA. We make history videos. And you're right, tonight's guest played Major League Baseball. He was a third baseman from 1971 to 1980 with the Minnesota Twins, Chicago White Sox, Texas Rangers, and New York Yankees. He hit 102 career home runs. He played with some of the most iconic players of all time. And managers. And he has this amazing Sauter World Wellness Center and Academy, a healing arts center in Willowbrook, Illinois. Welcome to the show, Mr. Eric Soderholm.
Hi, Peter. I think it was appropriate you played Memory Song there because you got to be old to remember me. That's a long time ago, baby.
Well, you're my era because I was the 70s. That's when I was a young fella, and I was really into it, and you were playing against when you'd play. I was all those games. You're playing against when you played Cleveland. And so, you know, I wrote down the names of these, so many of the guys you played with, and I don't think we'll get through all of them. Hopefully you'll be able to come back. Now, I wanted to start 1971. I'm interested in your thoughts on teammates and managers, starting off with your first manager, Bill Rigney. What do you remember about Bill Rigney?
Oh, boy, you're taxing my brain now. I would say, a nice older gentleman, kind of different from a lot of managers. He wasn't, I played a little bit under Billy Martin and a few of the managers that were considerably more fiery, if you will. He was kind of a laid-back kind of dude and knew he had a pretty good team with the Twins. I mean, we had Harmon Killebrew and Rod Carew and Tony Oliva and Bobby Allison and Cesar. I mean, we had some really good ball players. Unfortunately, that was during the time that the Oakland A's, as you remember, had the great, great team with Catfish Hunter and Raleigh Fingers and stuff. And we would always finish second. It seemed like the whole time I was with the Twins, they would finish first and we would finish second. And so it was frustrating, but it was a great honor to play with guys like Hall of Fame players like Harmon Killebrew and Tony Oliva and Rod Carew. I got a great Rod Carew story I can share with you. I don't know
sure.
how long are we going to be on the air, because I got a bunch of stories and I don't want to get you in trouble for going too long here. But
No, go ahead. We got a half an hour.
Oh, okay. Playing the Baltimore Orioles, Rod Carew, you know, won 7 American League batting championship titles. And this particular night, I hit the ball on the nose 4 times. 2 of them I thought were home runs. I hit a line drive with Doug DeCentes. Hit a line drive up the middle. Mark Belanger snagged, and I'm 0-for-4. And Rod Carew, the same night, got 5 hits, and I don't think a ball left the infield. 2, he drag bunted twice. Perfect. You couldn't roll him down there any better. He hit 2 ground balls up the middle that Belanger got to, but Rod was very fast, beat him out. And the last one, Peter, honestly got hits home plate, goes straight up in the air some 20 feet, and he pitches waiting for it to come down. He catches it, fires the first, and was boom, boom, safe. Man got 5 hits, and I'm 0-for-4 with 4 rockets. And I mean to tell you, it was crazy. I'm sitting in the sauna after the game, and he happens to walk in, and I said, Rod, I said, you got a magic wand. I've never seen anybody get base hits like you. And he laughed, and he said, no, I don't have a magic wand. You want to know the difference between me and you, Eric? And I said, sure. He said, can you look me in the eye and tell me from your heart that you believe you're a 300 hitter in the big leagues? I said, whoa, I've only been up 2 years. I don't think I can look you in the eye and tell you that, and honestly. And he said, my friend, that's why the base hits fall in for me, because I got to tell you something. I don't believe I'm a 300 hitter. I know I'm a 300 hitter. And that was very powerful for me. It was like right there, that lesson about your belief system in you, what you're capable of, how confident you can be. He just exuded confidence. He just knew that he was a Hall of Fame player, and it was a pleasure to play with him and all of those guys. Matter of fact, good team. We never won anything because of Oakland, but it was a great team to play for, a bunch of good guys.
How about George Mitterwald? What do you remember about him?
George was the catcher. Just kind of a, you know, nice guy, just decent guy. Wasn't anything, not a Hall of Fame player, just like I wasn't a Hall of Fame player, but steady and consistent and, nice guy, could throw out some runners. And we had Randy Hundley too, had a little cup of coffee during my time there too. And he was a great catcher. Just a great, good team overall. Just guys were fun to play with. We just didn't quite have enough talent.
Joey from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. The money in baseball is getting crazy. Hey, Eric, don't you wish Steve Cohen was around when you were playing instead of Calvin Griffith?
Yeah, Calvin Griffith was as tight as you could be as an owner, and I don't blame him. The minimum salary, you can look it up, it's true. The minimum salary back when I played in the 70s was $4,000 a year. I got to tell you, my first year I only hit 188, but my second year I hit 276. I'm making $14,000 minimum salary 2 years in a row, and I go into Calvin Griffith and say, Mr. Griffith, I hit 276. I had a pretty good year for you, pretty solid defensively, and I'm thinking maybe $25,000 raise. Honest to God, Peter, you'd have thought I shot him. he pulls open a drawer, pulls out a piece of paper, and on the piece of paper he's got like 10 or 12 times where he thought I screwed up the game. He said, "Look at here. On April 16th, you popped up with the bases loaded in the bottom of the ninth. On June 2nd, you hit into a double play." I mean, literally, ridiculously, he had 12 reasons why I should be third year in the big league making $14,000 a year. I held out for 2 weeks in spring training. I said, Mr. Griffith, I'm not playing for the minimum salary again. I held out for 2 weeks. His secretary calls me, and he says, Mr. Griffith is reconsidered. Come on in and sign. You get your new contract. I'm going in all excited thinking, well, I got my $25,000. I go in there and he pushes a contract towards me. It's $16,000. He says, here's a $2,000 raise. Be thankful that you got that, because if you don't take it, you can go sell fish in Miami where you're from. I mean, that is the kind of owner that I was dealing with back in the 70s. And when I had an opportunity to be a free agent in 1976, I certainly jumped on it. Four teams drafted me, and the White Sox were one of them. And Bill Veeck, even though I was coming off a knee surgery, Bill Veeck doubled my salary to $55,000 and guaranteed it even if I couldn't play. So I had to leave Minnesota, and I didn't really want to. I mean, I liked Minnesota because with the last name Soderholm, which I changed the pronunciation to Soderholm because it had more of a baseball ring to it. And so a lot of Swedes up in Minnesota. So it would have been a great place for me to have a lengthy career up there, but it was too hard with as tight as he was with money. I remember watching Harmon Killebrew sign the first ever $100,000 a year contract in the dugout. The cameras, the TV cameras, everybody was, all these reporters were in there. This was unbelievable that a player was making $100,000. And now, a bunch of years later, it's what, $780 is the minimum salary? You're almost a millionaire just going up and sitting on the bench nowadays. Harmon Killebrew, $100,000.
What else do you remember about Harmon Killebrew?
Well, he was a Mormon, and, you know, they had strict rules, I guess, in that religion. I don't know them all. But he would sneak off and grab an ice cream and go sit in the sauna and eat an ice cream. I guess one of the rules was you weren't supposed to eat ice cream back then, like the Catholics said, don't eat fish on Friday or some ridiculous thing. So he was always hiding, eating the ice cream in the sauna. That's what I remember most. Obviously, the thing you remember most was the Titanic home runs that he hit. I mean, they painted a seat blue up in the upper deck in left field out of the old Met Stadium. And he hit that. That had to be over 500 yards, that bolt that he hit. And it had a big X on a seat up there where Harmon Killebrew hit this home run. Crazy. I tried to copy his swing for a little while because everybody feared him at bat. And I used to hold my bat on my shoulder and then kind of push it out. Like, remember how he used to just push his hands out away from his body? I don't know if you remember that or not, but. He had quite a unique batting style, but man, he was a powerful little guy, man. He couldn't be but 5'10", 5'11", maybe at the max, but man, he was built like a fire plug, man. Very strong. Nice, nice gentleman. Nice, nice guy. Always great to the fans. Really a class act, Harmon was.
Yeah, that, going back to that 77 White Sox team, the Southside Hitmen, that was really something. That was really an amazing team.
It was a bunch of Bad News Bears kind of thing that Bill Veeck put together. I mean, when you go around and you look at that team, I had come off a knee surgery, so my range wasn't good. I was a step and a dive kind of player at third. Alan Bannister was our shortstop, and he had rotator cuff surgery. George Orta was our second baseman, and he was very stiff at trying to turn a double play. Could hit well. And then Lamar Johnson and Jim Spencer shared first base duties. Zisk was in right, and he was not a cast off, but I mean, he didn't have any range. Ralph Garr was in left. I mean, he was fast, but every time a ball was hit out there, you'd have to hold your breath to make sure, you know, that it was caught. The only legitimate player we had, I thought, that was covered everything was Chet Lemon in center field. He was a solid all-around player. I thought the best athlete that we had on that team. But it was, we set a record. We set a record for the most home runs ever hit by a team in the history of baseball that year. It since has gotten broken many times over, especially since the steroid era took place after the fact. But, I mean, it was exciting to be a part of a team that had a five-game lead late in August, and we were like 100-1 in Vegas. Nobody could believe it. We were there. But we didn't badly in the last month of the season. We probably played 500, I want to say 15-15 in the last 30 games. But Kansas City went like 24-6 or something in the last 30 games. It went by us like we were standing still. But nonetheless, it was an exciting year. And even at the charity golf outings that I play at now, people come up to me and say, man, that Southside Hitman team, that was my favorite team. I hear that all the time, even though we didn't win the pennant. It was a fun year. A lot of people had a lot of fun going to the park watching us hit home runs that year.
There was a real spirit. Well, you got, like you said, all these home runs, and then the spirit. I mean, Chicago hadn't won, won a World Series in so long, and then you guys were winning and hitting. So I remember that spirit and the excitement that White Sox. And I'm sure, yeah, today I'm sure White Sox, they're still very beloved. All the guys are still very beloved who played on that team.
Yeah,
go ahead.
A lot of them have died. I mean, Oscar Gamble has passed away. Jim Spencer passed away. I think Chet Lemon had a liver transplant. Francisco Berrios, one of our great pitchers then, he passed away. So it's like all these guys that I play with are dying, but I don't feel like I'm even close yet. So I don't know what's going on, man.
Well, you've gotten into this alternative health practices that are, you know, that are, I'm sure, helping you a lot, because our healthcare system isn't well, and you have to have a good state of mind and, you know, healthy lifestyle and so forth. But David from Chelmsford, Massachusetts, Rod Carew, George Brett, Tony Gwynn, Pete Rose, Wade Boggs, the best five players in his book. Any comment, Mr. Soderholm?
Did he say George Brett?
Yeah, Rod Carew, George Brett, Tony Gwynn, Pete Rose, Wade Boggs.
Yeah, that's a powerful group of five players. I guess obviously because I play with Rod Carew, I really appreciate how good he was. But I think of that list of guys that I played against, or would be the guy that I leaned towards. There was George Brett. This guy could single-handedly beat you. I mean, when I was on the Yankees in '80. We won 104 games, had the best team, I think, by far in either league. And we played Kansas City in the first round, and George Brett got hot. I think he hit three home runs in a short series and beat us. And that was quite a shock. I mean, the whole world was shocked. I think we were 3-1 favorites. So it just shows you that on any given day, anybody can win. George Brett was the best overall player that I think I played against, yeah.
Robert from Louisville, Kentucky, the 1970s were the best. Mustaches, wild uniforms, and cheap owners. Bill Veeck, Charlie Finley, Calvin Griffith, Marge Schott, and Bud Selig.
The Oakland Finley guy with the orange baseballs, that was big. Bill Veeck with the entertainment. He wanted everybody to get their money's worth when they came to watch Chicago, because he wasn't sure how good the team was going to be, but he wanted to make sure you were entertained with trapeze artists or midgets or whatever. You know, he was just a great man, a great promoter. I love Bill Veeck. He was like my second father. He gave me a chance to play when some of the doctors didn't think I was going to be able to come back from the serious knee operation I had. But he took a chance on me. And I remember going, and when I went to sign my contract with the White Sox, I asked if I could do two things. One, I wanted to stand out at third base and kind of get a feel if it felt good. And secondly, I wanted to meet Bill Veeck. Well, Roland Heeman was the, who just recently passed away, was the general manager. And he said, well, we can probably arrange both of those, but are you aware that there's over a foot of snow outside? And so I said, I don't care. So I went outside in a foot of snow and stood at third base and just looked around, and it just felt right. And then he got a taxi for me and took me over to the Illinois Masonic Hospital. Bill Veeck was in the hospital for emphysema and a bad back. And so I opened up the hospital door, and there he was with his hospital gown on, his chest hanging out, his wooden leg propped up on a pillow. And the first thing I noticed was the ashtray that he had built into his wooden leg. And the thought that crossed my mind was not, hi, Bill, nice to meet you. It was like, well, no wonder you're in the hospital for emphysema. If you got to have an ashtray built into a wooden leg, you got a big problem. And that's what I was thinking. But I went up to him and introduced myself, and he said, we're so glad you signed with us. We need a solid utility man that can play several positions. And I said, Mr. Veeck, I worked very hard at coming back from this knee surgery. I'm not going to be a utility man for you. I'm going to be your everyday third baseman and have a great year. And he said, Eric, if you do that, you come see me at the end of the year and I'll take care of you. I said, well, you already did by giving me $55,000 offer on free agency, in that free agency pool. And he said, no, I'll take care of you. And so sure enough, I go out, hit 280 with 25 dingers, and I had my best year ever. And after the season was over, in my locker was a note, come see me, Bill Beck. Went upstairs, and he had a two-year contract for me for $300,000, $150,000 a year, which to me was like millions. You know, to go from $14,000 with the Twins for about 3 or 4 years almost, making less than $20,000 in the big leagues, to go and now jump after that good year to $300,000. That was big for me, and I remembered him telling me that, I'll take good care of you if you do that. And so he was a man of his word. He was a big-time promoter, wanted people to have fun when they came to the park. And he was like my second father. I really enjoyed playing for Bill Beck.
That's why it's so cool talking to you, because the last Cleveland Indians World Series title was Bill Beck was the owner in 1948. And I know he had that, and later in life, you were with him in Chicago, and they had – there was some excitement. So I love to hear about stuff about Bill Beck. What do you remember about Tony Oliva?
Well, I sympathized with him a lot later in my career, because when I hurt my knee and I saw how difficult it was to play on a bad knee, and you're having to get cortisone shots every 6 weeks to try to kill the pain, Tony had 7 knee operations, and when he hit a base hit, a line drive to right, there was a chance that they could throw him out of first base. That's how poorly he ran. But he was a pure hitter, just a fine gentleman, and I love Tony a lot. And I saw where he's in the Twins Hall of Fame, and him and Bly Levin and those guys. Good guys. Bert was probably one of my best friends. Steve Bry, Danny Thompson. They were good friends. I'll never forget Bert. I came up in the minor leagues with Bert. You're gonna love this story. And Bert Blylevin was a practical joker. I mean, you'd sit in the dugout and he'd sneak behind you and put a match in your shoe and light it, you know, give you a hot foot. I mean, that's the kind of prankster he was. And still is to this day, I'm sure. But I remember my wife in the minor league said, well, let's invite Bert and Patty, his wife then, and Danny and Steve and their wives over for Thanksgiving in November. This is in the wintertime. And I said, sure. So we invited them over, and they said, sure. My wife spends like 3 days preparing this beautiful Thanksgiving meal with the turkey and the stuffing and the whole nine. They put her heart and soul in this thing. And so my wife, being a Southern Baptist at that time, way back then, said, all right, let's all hold hands, and who would like to say the blessing? And Bert raised his hand, I will. And then he said, oh, okay, Bert, you lead us in prayer. He turns around and farts on the turkey. He says, amen. Honest to God, my wife starts bawling, and she runs to the bathroom, and all the wives chased after, tried to console her. And Bert said, what? What's wrong? Get the knife. Let's carve this up. I mean, that's the kind of guy Bert was. Just a prankster. Great guy. I love Bert. He ended up being a pretty good friend of mine. I've lost touch with him now, but just had a bunch of real characters on that team.
Sal from Germantown, Pennsylvania. How cold was it to play in Minnesota before the Homer Dome?
It was very cold. Pete's from New York. He knows what that's all about. Man, I feel sorry for those people in the Buffalo area. I was born in Cortland, New York, and it just seems like every year these poor people get just blasted every year. And here we're here in Chicago, we're on the other side of the lake, and it's like the winters are like mild. I mean, we just had a fairly decent storm, but it was only like 3 inches of snow. Got a little cold for a day or two, but this week is supposed to be in the 50s. So the global warming thing is good for us on this side of the lake, not so good for them on the other side. So, yeah, I was born in Cortland, New York, so I really feel badly for those people in Buffalo area. We're only about 2.5-3 hours from Buffalo, where I was born.
What do you remember about Leo Cardenas?
Well, I have a good story about him. I got called up at the end of the season. You know how they call up the people in the minor leagues in September. And this was, I think, in 1969 with Billy Martin managing the Minnesota Twins. And so I got there, and I figured Billy's, we're in a pennant race, so I figured Billy's not going to play me. But it was fun, you know, being around the guys and seeing what it was like to be in the big leagues. And Leo Cardenas, my first night, I'm just sitting there minding my own business, watching the game. He makes three errors in Oakland, three. And Billy Martin is going berserk in the dugout. You know, he had a little anger issue. just a small one.
Uh-huh.
He had a Napoleon complex, small guy, wanted to beat everybody up, you know. But he got so mad at Leo Cardenas for making the third error. He comes over to me, just minding my own business on the bench, and points his finger right in my face and says, "Rookie, you get your rest tomorrow, and because you're going to be in there tomorrow night. I can't stand watching that SOB play." And I, you know, it scared the snot out of me, and it was like, oh, well, I guess I'm going to get to play after all. I didn't think I was going to, just being called up. And so I go home, get my rest, and eat two good meals before I go to the park, all excited I'm going to play, and get there, and Leo Cardenas is in the lineup and not me. So I lost a little respect for Billy Martin that evening. He was a great manager, fiery kind of guy, certainly a complete opposite of Bill Rigney. You know, so we had a few different contrasting managers in my day, but Billy was one of them, and he loved to win, and he couldn't stand losing. And, you know, I don't know. I'm a competitor too, but part of winning is learning how to be a good loser also. I mean, you're not going to win every game, so you got to be able to handle the losses, you know, and Billy didn't handle losses very well, that's for sure.
Would you like to talk about your Sodder World Wellness Center and Academy?
Thanks for letting me plug that. I got to be honest with you, Peter. I'm more proud of creating this place with my family, Sodder World, than I was of playing 9.5 years in the big leagues. And the reason is, playing in the big leagues, you know, you can, the fans are behind you and you win. They experience the winning energy, and that's all exciting. We all share that winning energy that we love. That's universal. But the Sodder World, there's something about that place. Created it because I had a company prior to Sodder World called Front Row Tickets. I got in the business world after my baseball career, didn't know anything about business world, but I had a name recognition and got in the ticket business and helped get people concert tickets, ball game tickets, this and that. I fell into a contact that helped me get seats. But it was all about greed and money. And I remember people calling me and say, "I need 4 cup tickets for the weekend." And I say, "Well, it's like $175 a ticket." "What?" "Well, listen, I paid $150 to get them. The Cubs are hot right now, you know." And I'm lying through my teeth. I paid like $85, you know what I mean? And I'm just being honest with you. And so I got on a different path when I hit my 50s, early 50s. And more about how important it was to be truthful in your life. And the ticket business just was grinding on me because it was about greed and ripping people off. And so my daughter went to work out in California. She was a professional massage therapist, and she went out to California to do advanced training. And she went to work for a guy named Deepak Chopra. I don't know if you know him or not, but he's one of these pretty big spiritual leaders out of San Diego on the West Coast. And after she worked for him for a year or two, she became one of his top therapists and said, "Dad, we got to do what he's doing in the Midwest. The Chicago area really needs this, a place where people can go and just relieve stress and work on themselves, trying to find that inner peace. And it has nothing to do with religion." And I said, "Okay, let's do it." And so we started in with 1,000 square feet in the shopping center, little strip mall, and people started coming. And then we expanded it to 2,000 square feet and created the yoga studio, knocked down the wall, created a bigger place. And then in the third year of a 5-year contract, we created the people went out of business, and we took that space too. So we had 3,000 square feet and created a real nice center, but it still had that shopping center cold feel, you know. Well, there was a lady that came in for her massage, and she was about 20 minutes late. And I said, ma'am, you're going to put us behind. We can't, I don't know if we can accommodate you for a full hour massage. We might have to cut it in half. And she said, oh, no, this is why I'm late. And she plots down directions to Solder World that were downloaded on MapQuest off Google. And it said that Solder World was located on Route 83 and Nielsen Lane. And it had a big circle and an X there. She says, I went down to Route 83 and Nielsen Lane, and there's nothing there but a wooded piece of property and some houses on a cul-de-sac in the back. I was actually knocking on people's house door asking where's Solder World. And one lady came to the front. She said, I think it's in the shopping center up the street. I said, oh, my God, we're going to have to call MapQuest and get that fixed. Well, she goes in. I said, well, give me your hour massage. She leaves. There's a guy, honest to God, Peter, there's a guy sitting in the lobby waiting for his wife to come out of her massage. He jumps up and says, hi, Eric. My name's Joe Just. I know you. You don't know me. I work for Remax Realtors. I overheard that conversation about Nielsen Lane. I want you to know that I work for Remax Realtors, and we're the listing agent for that property that's being sold that she talked about. And I personally have sold that property twice myself, and it fell through because it's a wetland piece of property. And you can't build on the back. But he said, maybe someday they'll let you create a little meditation walking garden or something like that, but you can use the front and create this building because our five-year lease was almost up. And I said, wow, that sounds like a pretty good idea. To make a long story short, he helped me get the loans from the bank, and we built it as we wanted it. My dad used to build A-frame dollhouses when I was a kid, and that was the inspiration behind the building. If you go on the Internet and look up Solder World, you'll see pictures of the A-frame log cabin. And so we started Solder World, and it's all about helping people go within and heal. You know, too many people can't live in the moment and enjoy this moment because they're stuck with stuff that they're attached to from the past, the things that happened to them. And they live in kind of victim consciousness because of that. Or people are in the future worrying about paying the bills or whatever. And it takes you out of the moment. And if you read Eckhart Tolle's stuff or whatever, it's about the power of now, being in the now all the time and feeling that peace and joy within. So we teach people how to find that with no religious. It has nothing to do with religion. We teach it through meditation. We teach it through yoga. We teach it through hypnosis. We all kinds of modalities that we offer, professional massage. And so it's just become a place that people are just coming to in droves now. And I'm just very, very proud of creating that with my family. And it's a special place. And people think I'm crazy when I say I'm more proud of creating Solder World than I am of playing 9.5 years in the big leagues, but it's true.
Wow, that's amazing. We're out of time. I'm in self-realization fellowship, yoga, meditation. It's everything to me. So anyway, that's tremendous. We're gonna our guest tonight has been Eric Soderholm, MLB player from 1971 to 1980. And thank you so much for coming on the show, Mr. Soderholm. We'll try to schedule you to come on again and talk some more.
Oh yeah, I got lots of stories for you, Peter. Call anytime, buddy. Appreciate you having me on.
Oh, thank you so much. God bless you. Wonderful work. Next week, we're going to have Bill North back again, the starting center fielder and leadoff hitter for the coolest MLB team of all time, the Oakland A's from the early 1970s. Dear listener, may the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Good night, everybody. Thanks again so much, Mr. Eric Soderholm.
Thank you, brother.
Wonderful.